Srinivas.
Srinivas Raghavan.
Raghavan. Okay, now we can be started.
No, sir, I'm just checking. Bandwidth is showing low. I'm just checking out.
Okay. Najib.
Yeah. Good afternoon, friends. And first of all, to happy festive day for all our friends. And may they all stay blessed in the festivity. And today's session, we had requested Mr. Ram Kumar, a former judge of Kerala High Court, who takes the sessions in his own way. The Q&A format, I think, at least I have not come across where we take sessions in the question and answer form. He has his own style. As they said, that successful people don't do different things, they do it differently. Or from their famous judgment of the Dhar Court, wherein they say that it's not important to be number one, but it is important to be unique because you are only the number one, from Justice Sikri's judgment. And same we can say about Justice Ram Kumar's same style of this thing. And while we do different aspects of law, the testimonial credibility of a child witness is an issue which normally comes up in the mind of a person. As if he's a child, normally we say that all decisions are to be taken by an adult. But whether the child's testimony and his credentials, what will be done? And as we have shared the questions shared by Justice Ram Kumar coupled with the sections, the primary interplay will be with the Section 118 of the Evidence Act coupled with the Oath Commission Act. I'll just read for the convenience of the participants the two sections of the Oath Act 1969 as well as 118 of the Indian Evidence Act. And then normally we will ask Justice Ram Kumar to give a bird eye view before the eagle takes off for the right flights as such. And the Indian Evidence Act, Section 118, who may testify? All persons shall be competent to testify unless the court considers that they are prevented from understanding the questions put to them or from giving rational answers to those questions by tender years, extreme old, disease, whether of body or mind or any other cause of same kind. Explanation. A lunatic is not incompetent to testify unless he is prevented by his lunacy from understanding the questions put to him and giving rational answers to them. Oaths Act 1969, Section 4. Oaths or affirmations to be made by witnesses, interpreters, and jurors. Oaths and affirmations shall be made by the following persons, namely, all witnesses, that is to say, all persons who may lawfully be examined to or give or be required to give evidence by or before any only court, by any, before any court or person having by law or consent of parties authority to examine such witnesses or to receive evidence. Interpreter of questions put to and evidence given by witnesses and jurors. Provided that where the witness is a child under 12 years of age and the court or person having authority to examine such witness is of opinion that though the witness understands the duty of speaking the truth, it does not understand the nature of an oath or affirmation. The foregoing provisions of this section and the provisions of Section 5 shall not apply to such witness. But in any such case, the absence of an oath or affirmation shall not render inadmissible any evidence given by such witness, nor affect the obligation of the witness to state the truth. Nothing in this section shall render it lawful to admission in a criminal proceedings an oath or affirmation to the accused person, unless he is examined as a witness for the defense or necessary to admission to the official interpreter of any court after he has entered on the execution of the duties of his office, an oath or affirmation that he will faithfully discharge those duties. So as we see, these are the two sections where there is an interplay regarding the session of today. And today we have 25 questions, which not will be have silver lining the entire aspects to understand the child testimony. And we will take questions amongst from the audience who will read those questions. And as usual, Justice Ram Kumar will give his insights coupled with the facts that the participants, not only on this platform, but they can also share their insights on this on the YouTube channel or the Facebook. We will take those questions. And those who are on the YouTube, they can like, subscribe, and comment also. And any other session which you feel that any speaker, including this is Ram Kumar, can make things more simplified in the manner which we normally do, we can take those sessions also. And amongst us, we have Mr. Shyam Padman also joining. I will unmute him, and as usual, I will ask him, as he says that at the last minute, the accolades have to be given to him. We will ask him to say a few words about this session. And then I will ask Mr. KVJ Rao to take the first question. Mr. Shyam. I don't know whether he had...
He has to be unmuted.
Yeah,
unmuted.
He has to be unmuted. Yeah.
Please unmute him.
He's unmuted, sir. Unmuted. You can't silence him. Yes, sir. Shyamji.
Yes.
A formal introduction.
My God. You are late. This is Ram Kumar, sir. Wonderful. I would say that it's a privilege and pleasure and a surprise also, because I just stepped in because I had a meeting otherwise. So I was a bit delayed and I just rushed in because I could not miss out on this session, especially on this topic, testimonial credibility of a child witness, because many a doubt linger in our minds regarding to what extent, how a judge decides whether it can be accepted, is it credible, and what are the things that weigh in the mind of this process, that only the person who has done it, experienced it, can only speak about it. Otherwise, it'll be just like learning swimming through correspondence course. Now we have the man who know what exactly to look for and how you can tell others to decide on what parameters or on what broad guidelines. I mean, you cannot have a hard and fast rule that if X is applicable to a particular child, may not apply to, it is just like body language. If somebody says that if you speak in such and such manner, that is a lie or a truth. But if he's even otherwise like that, nobody can say like. So I would say that today we are privileged with the presence of Justice Ram Kumar, sir, to address on a very pertinent and very, very, I'll say special topic, because it's a topic in itself. And especially congratulate Vikas for choosing the topic and the speaker for the topic. And I see all my friends here in this platform today. It's indeed a privilege. We have the gentleman judge in whose court it was always a pleasure to argue or present things, because he knew that nothing else mattered, only the merit of the case. So, over to you.
Thank you, Mr. Shah. Good evening, friends, and Eid Mubarak to one and all of you.
Eid Mubarak, sir.
Eid Mubarak.
Now, the Indian Evidence Act 1872 or the Code of Criminal Procedure 1973, both these statutes do not define the expression child witness. A child witness is clubbed along with all other witnesses of all age groups, including persons with disease of the body and mind, under Section 118 of the Evidence Act. The only rider is that while dealing with a child witness, the court has to consider the tender age of the child, its capacity of understanding the questions put to it, and its capacity to give rational answers to those questions. These are the yardsticks to be applied by every court dealing with a child witness. This capacity may vary from person to person. The age of 12 years has nothing to do with under Section 118 of the Evidence Act, but it has got some relevance under the Oaths Act 1969 in the matter of administering oath to a child witness. Now, with this, I have my usual caveat that I don't consider me as an expert in criminal law, much less an expert on child witness, and I believe that every law is better understood when applied to concrete fact situations. That explains these questions. And if you are able to answer these questions correctly with reference to the case law, interpreting all these sections, you become a master of the profession. And every legal practitioner will have to confront this question at one stage or the other. Now we pass on to the questions. First question, who will read?
Sir Rao. Hi. Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
Mr. Shyam, you have taken out the printout?
Yes, I have. Should I go for the first question?
Yeah.
Is there any difference under the English law and the Indian law with regard to a child witness?
There is a difference. In England, a child to be a competent witness should have the requisite understanding regarding the nature of oath and the consequence of stating falsehood. Unlike in India, the court will ascertain by examining the infant whether it knows the nature of testifying on oath and the consequence of punishment upon lying. Similarly, in England, the unsworn testimony of a child could be received in evidence only if the same was corroborated in some material particulars implicating the accused. But in India, the law in India is slightly different. As early as in the year 1946, the Privy Council in Mohammad Sugal Isa versus the King, AIR 1946 PC, page 3, made this following observation. In England, where provision has been made for the reception of unsworn evidence from a child, it has always been provided that the evidence must be corroborated in some material particulars implicating the accused. But in Indian acts, there is no such provision and evidence is made admissible whether corroborated or not. Once there is admissible evidence, the court can act upon it. It is a sound rule in practice not to act on uncorroborated evidence of a child, whether sworn or unsworn. But this is a rule of prudence and not of law. Now, what do you mean by corroboration? See, when a witness testifies on oath, either on oath or otherwise, before a court of law during the course of trial, it is called substantive evidence. What do you call it, substantive evidence? Substantive evidence doesn't require any support. It can stand on its own legs. Substantive evidence, the testimony, oral testimony of a witness in court is called substantive evidence. But supposing there is no oral evidence, no oral testimony, or rather there is an oral testimony, oral testimony falling under Section 60 of the Evidence Act, something which a person has perceived through his senses. I have seen an occurrence taking place. I have seen a crime being committed. I have heard the voices of the victim. I have seen them. I have perceived them with my senses. Then evidence is admissible only by a person who has perceived with his senses. But supposing there is no direct testimony regarding or eyewitness regarding it an offense, but there is only circumstantial evidence. Somebody had seen the accused going near the victim or going to the victim's house. Somebody had seen the accused buying a chopper. Somebody else had seen the accused going from the house of the victim with the chopper, with blood dripping from the chopper. These are all circumstances from which an inference can be reasonably be made. But those circumstances do not have the strength of an eyewitness. Eyewitness is a person who has directly seen the occurrence. Therefore, in circumstances evidence, you may require something else, some supporting evidence for corroborating. Whereas in the case of an eyewitness, you don't require anybody, any other corroborating evidence, any other supporting evidence, because it is the substantive evidence. It can stand on its own legs. That is what we call when we say substantive evidence. But in the case of a child witness, courts have adopted some principles which we will definitely show. Thus, if a court in India, after preliminary examination, now whenever a child witness is in the witness box, court will have to conduct a preliminary examination called voir dire examination. Voir dire. And to satisfy whether the child is competent to testify. The child witness can be examined as any other witness, but the testimony of such a child witness will be subject to the usual safeguards to be applied in the case of such witnesses who are easily prone to tutoring and other influences. They can be easily tutored. They can be subjected to all other influences. Therefore, these are the usual safeguards applied by courts while evaluating the testimony of a child witness. They are fickle minded. They very easily they are they are amenable to influence. They are amenable to tutoring. Therefore, courts will have to guard against all such influences while evaluating the testimony of a child witness. Yes. Now, question number two.
Sir, we recognize the presence of Justice P.S. Narayana, sir, also on this
panel. Ah, yes, yes.
Sir, welcome, sir. Sir, when you said about...
Sir.
Thank you. You are a great jurist and author.
Authored more than 180 books.
Yes, you are right.
So incidentally, when you said about the difference between the English or American jurisprudence and our jurisprudence regarding being a child or a minor, even in another jurisprudence, that is in medical jurisprudence, we have something known as Gillick-Aware and Fraser guidelines, wherein even a child under 16, if the court finds that he or he is able to comprehend the situation, that consent is good enough. Whereas in India, our age limit is very particular.
Yes, yes. You're right. Question number two.
We have unmuted Justice P.S.
Okay.
Narayana, sir.
Narayana. Who will read question number two?
I will read. We have unmuted. Mr. Rao will take it, but we have unmuted Justice P.S. Narayana so that we can have his insights also. And we are enamored by the fact that he has joined us.
Definitely.
Welcome, sir, on the platform of Beyond Law.
Welcome, sir.
Okay. Privileged listener.
Yes, Rao, sir.
Question two. What is the meaning of voir dire?
The meaning of voir dire is to speak the truth. To speak the truth is the meaning. Yes, question three.
Yes, sir. Voir dire is an English word, a Latin word, a Greek word, a French word, a Persian word. Which of the above is correct?
It is a French word. Unusually, very often we come across Latin expressions only in maxims of in-law. But here it is a French word, which means to speak the truth. You can refer to Black's Law Dictionary for this. Yes, question number four.
Yeah. I will take the fourth question. If Mr. Professor Mohan also has the question, then he can take the questions. You have, sir?
Right, sir.
Fourth question.
Fourth question.
Yes.
What is meant by voir dire examination and what is its application?
The voir dire was originally applied in the context of preliminary examination by a judge of a prospective juror. Juror is a person who serves on the body of persons called the jury panel to decide whether the prospect is qualified and suitable to serve on the jury panel. Voir dire is also preliminary examination by a judge to test the competence of a witness. This is very often employed in the case of child witnesses or other witnesses under some disability to ascertain their testimonial competence, whether they are competent to testify. That is the usual test applied by courts, voir dire examination, to speak the truth, whether to find out whether the witness is able to speak the truth or witness is in a mood to speak the truth. That is the usual test applied. Yes. Question number five.
Mr. Shyam. Question number five relates to the Oath Act, which you mentioned earlier, sir. What is its relevance in the matter of oaths and affirmations to be made by witnesses, interpreters, etc. in a court of law?
The Oaths Act 1969, which came into force on 26-12-1969, after repealing the Indian Oaths Act of 1873, is the law applicable in India relating to oaths. Section 3(1) of the Oaths Act 1969 empowers courts and persons having power to receive evidence to do so after administering oath or affirmation. In the case of affidavits for the purpose of judicial proceedings, the High Court can empower under Section 3(2)(a) of the Oaths Act any court, judge or magistrate or other person to administer oath or affirmation. Similarly, under Section 3(2)(b), the state government is given the power to authorize any court, judge or magistrate or other person to administer oath or affirmation in respect of affidavits other than those used for the purpose of judicial proceeding. So if it is an affidavit for the purpose of judicial proceeding, High Court can empower. if it is for a purpose other than judicial proceeding, the state government can empower. Section 4 of the Oaths Act 1969 enjoins that all witnesses, interpreters, and jurors shall make oath or affirmation while performing their duties as such before courts or other persons having under Section 3(1) of the authority to receive evidence. There are, apart from courts, there are certain persons under acting under various statutes and empowered to receive evidence. Those persons are also, before receiving evidence, are bound to administer oath or affirmation to the witness who is going to be examined. As per Section 8 of the Oaths Act, every person giving evidence on any subject before a court or a person authorized to administer oath or affirmation shall be bound to state the truth. In under Section 161(2), you might have seen that a police officer conducting an investigation under Chapter 12 of the CRPC, when he has got the power to orally examine a person who is supposed to be acquainted with the facts and circumstances of the case. Courts have taken the view that any person acquainted with the facts and circumstances of the case will include not only witnesses, but also even the accused. He is the best person who is acquainted with the circumstances, facts and circumstances of the case. He is the offender. Therefore, under Section 161, the police officer can orally examine a person who is supposed to be acquainted with the facts and circumstances of the case. And supposing a police officer is orally examining a witness or interrogating a witness, that witness is bound to state the truth. That is what Section 161(2) says. Likewise, Oaths Act says when a person is deposing before a court of justice, court of law, he is bound to state the truth. That is what Section 4 says. Then, Section 6 of the Oaths Act 1969 deals with the forms of oath and affirmation, and Schedule to the Oaths Act gives the forms. Form number 1 of the schedule pertains to witnesses who give testimony before court. Then form number 2 pertains to jurors. Fortunately or unfortunately, we don't have the jury system in India now. We had the last vestige of jury system in Lakshadweep, I think. Lakshadweep, we had the last vestige of jury system. But there also it is abolished. Form number 3 of the schedule pertains to interpreters. See, when a witness is giving evidence before a court and the court is not familiar with the language of the witness, supposing before a court in Kerala, where the judges are generally knowing Malayalam, local vernacular, a witness from Delhi knowing only Hindi, supposing he is deposing, the judge may not be able to record this evidence. Therefore, the judge may have to requisition the services of an interpreter. So the interpreter who interprets the testimony of the witness will also have to take oath to the effect that I am truly interpreting, truly and honestly interpreting. That is why interpreter. Their form is form number 4. And form number 3. Then form number 4 is the form for affidavits under Section 3(2) of the Oaths Act. Affidavit, I already told you, there are two types of affidavits. Affidavits in respect to be used in respect of judicial proceedings where the High Court can authorize the magistrate or judge. And affidavits to be used otherwise than in judicial proceedings, state government can authorize the judge or magistrate. Question number six.
May I read?
Yes.
What is meant by administering oath to a witness and what is its purpose?
Oath is a solemn declaration accompanied by a swearing to God or a revered person or a thing that one's statement is true and that one will be bound by the promise. This is the purpose of oath. This is oath. The person making the oath implicitly invites punishment if the statement turns out to be false or if the promise is broken. The legal effect of oath is to subject the person to the penalty of perjury in the event of his statement turning out to be false. If his statement turns out to be false, he is aware that he is liable to be punished for perjury. If it, then Section 4 of the Oaths Act 1969 obliges every witness, interpreter and juror to make an oath or affirmation before his testimony is received in evidence. The main purpose of oath is to render the person who gives false evidence liable to be prosecuted for perjury. This is what a two-judge bench of the Supreme Court, speaking through Justice Vivian Bose in Rameshwar versus State of Rajasthan, AIR 1952 Supreme Court 5-4, the judges were Saeed Fazal Ali and Vivian Bose, judgment by Vivian Bose. Here the Supreme Court considered the identical provision in the Indian Oaths Act 1873. Yes.
Sir, in general, we look at administration of oath on the holy books.
Yeah, that is all. Some practice, that's all. Because and in the name of God, see? In the name of God. We had in Kerala one case where an MLA took oath in the name of Sri Narayana Guru, who has been considered to be a social reformer, not a god, actually.
Yes.
At the High Court.
Suppose an atheist appears, sir.
Then declaration. We'll come to that. That is
my,
the next. That is the next question. Next question.
Okay.
Please.
Yeah. Mr. Kurpaswamy will take it.
Right.
Yes. If the witness or other person is not a believer, but is a rationalist, has he got any option other than talking an oath in the name of God?
See, if the witness is not a believer in God, but is a rationalist, then has he got any option under the Oaths Act to not to take oath in the name of God? There is a provision in the Oaths Act. Instead of swearing to God, the witness, interpreter or juror concerned has an option under Section 5 of the Oaths Act to make an affirmation, which is a solemn pledge that is equivalent to an oath, but without reference to any supreme being. They don't believe in any supreme being. Such an affirmation also, if violated, will subject the person to the penalty of perjury. A rationalist make a solemn affirmation, whereas in the case of a other person, he may make a solemn oath in the name of God or a supreme being. And though there is no significant change in the case of oath or affirmation once it is violated. This was beautifully stated by a division bench of the Andhra Pradesh High Court in AIR 2000 Andhra Pradesh 427. AIR 2000 Andhra Pradesh 427. Godikari Ragamma versus Venganeni Tirupati. AIR 2000 Andhra Pradesh, page 427.
Godineni, yes. Versus Tirupati.
Okay, I am. please excuse my pronunciation.
No problem. Sir, the same is the case with the affidavit also, right? Affidavit also can be solemnly affirmed.
Affidavit, of course, definitely. If he has solemnly affirmed, and if his affirmation turns out to be false, he can be proceeded against.
Yes.
Especially an affidavit falling under Section 3-2 of the Oaths Act, either in judicial proceedings or in proceedings other than judicial proceedings. You have seen the distinction. One is the High Court empowering the magistrate or judge, the other the state government. Question 8.
Okay, is it correct that oath referred to in the Oaths Act 1969 is only a judicial oath?
Yes, it is only the judicial oath. Because the preamble of the Oaths Act itself clarifies that oath means judicial oath, to be in while giving evidence before a court or a person having authority to receive evidence. It was also declared so by the Supreme Court in Hira H. Advani versus State of Maharashtra, AIR 1971 Supreme Court 4-4, 4-4. Three judges of Supreme Court affirmed that oath means judicial oath. Question number 9.
Sir Rao.
Is the Oaths Act applicable to proceedings before the collector under Section 171A of the Sea Customs Act 1878?
The identical provision under the Indian Oaths Act 1873 was considered in a decision of the Supreme Court consisting of three judges, Hirai, same decision, Hirai H. Advani versus State of Maharashtra, where they held that the Oaths Act has no application to the proceedings of the collector acting under that statute, Sea Customs Act. There's no application. Even though he has the power to conduct an inquiry, the Oaths Act has no application. Next question is an ancillary to this question. Yes, question number 10.
Mr. Rao can take it.
Okay. If the Oath Act does not apply to the proceedings before the collector under the Sea Customs Act 1878, is the person making a statement before the collector under section 171A of the said act bound to state the truth?
The very same Supreme Court held that whether he, even if he there is no obligation under the act, under this Sea Customs Act, to while conducting an inquiry to administer oath, the person who is making a statement, he is bound to state the truth, failing which he will be liable for prosecution for perjury, punishable under section 193 of the Indian Penal Code. This is what the Supreme Court said. AR 1971 Supreme Court, 44, three judges. Question 11.
Is it not permissible to administer oath to an accused while a magistrate records his confession under section 164, clause 4 of the CRPC?
See, under what section 164 CRPC, the magistrate has got two jurisdictions. One, to record a confession of an accused. Two, to record a statement from a person who is not an accused, ordinarily not an accused. Even an accused can give a non-confessional statement. That is the purpose of 164.5. Now, when an accused is, when the confession of an accused is recorded, Supreme Court has taken the view that if an accused wants to make a confession, he need not be sponsored by the police. He can straightaway walk into the magistrate's court and say that I want to make a confession. I am an accused in such and such case. An investigation is in progress. If the magistrate is satisfied about these two conditions, one, whether he is an accused in the case, or when and whether an investigation is in progress, the magistrate can straightaway record his confession. Only yardstick is that before recording the confession, the magistrate should be satisfied that this person is making the confession without any extraneous influence, either by the police or anybody else. So yes, the magistrate has to be satisfied that the confession made is voluntarily made, voluntary confession. For that, the magistrate can even tell him, Mr. Accused, you are not bound to make a confession. This is the offense which is alleged against you. This offense is punishable up to punishable with imprisonment up to 3 years. Just because you make a confession, don't expect any leniency from me. I may have, depending on the gravity of the offense, I may have to award even the extreme sentence of 3 years, imprisonment of 3 years. Therefore, don't be under the impression that by making a confession, you are going to get a leniency from me. You are not bound to make a confession. Even after considering, after being aware of this, if you are prepared to make a confession, then only you need make a confession. I'll give you time for reflection. The magistrate can even adjourn it to the next day, asking the accused to come tomorrow. You think over it. You are not bound to make a confession. So in spite of that, the accused says, no, this is a case where I did commit this offense. I have the prick of my conscience. Therefore, he can make a confession. So while making that confession, the question is whether oath has to be administered to the accused. Oath cannot be administered to the accused.
It's a bar under section 164, class 5.
No, clause 5 says oath can be administered in the case of a statement recorded by a witness other than an accused.
Other than.
Except, yes. But the bar is actually under section 4.2 of the Oaths Act. Section 4.2 of the Oaths Act says no confession, no oath shall be administered to an accused under any circumstance. Only one circumstance is there. That is, if the accused is voluntarily mounting the witness box as a defense witness, 315. Under section 315, an accused can give evidence as a defense. He can voluntarily give evidence as a defense witness. In that case, He is mounting the witness box in the capacity of a witness. So he will have to tell the truth, state the truth. Therefore, oath can be administered. Except in such cases, no oath can be administered to an accused by virtue of Section 4.2 of the Oaths Act. 164.5, as you rightly said, 164.5 says, other than an accused, except an accused. In the case of a witness or a victim, while the magistrate recording the confession can, recording the statement can administer oath to a witness or victim. Supposing it is an accused who wants to make a non-confessional statement, then also he need not be sponsored by the police. But since it is a statement falling under 164.5, oath can be administered. Yes.
But in respect of witnesses,
yes,
to record their witness under Section 164.
Yes.
But in Murugasamy case, my lord, Madras High Court says
Justice P.N. Prakash.
Yes, yes. The witness has to be sponsored by...
Correct. Not that only Madras. That's what the Supreme Court said way back in 1999. A Supreme Court speaking through Justice K.T. Thomas held that if it is a witness or victim, he has to be sponsored by the police. Whereas if it is an accused, accused need not be sponsored by the police. Accused for to make a confession. Whereas in the case of a victim or witness, Murugasamy has only reiterated. Of course, Justice P.N. Prakash is a very knowledgeable jurist of a judge. I know him personally. Very enlightened judge. Yes.
Question number 12.
Yes.
Would it make any difference?
Would it make
any difference if the accused is examined as a defense witness under Section
315?
That already answered. Because
it already covered it.
No oath to be administered to an accused except when he is examined as a defense witness under Section 315 of the CRPC. Yes. Question 13. You can read 13 also.
Question 13. Will not the omission to take oath or affirmation or any irregularity in administering oath or affirmation invalidate the proceedings or at least render the evidence of the witness inadmissible?
Supposing in a case where oath ought to have been administered but not administered or omitted to be administered or there is some irregularity in administering the oath, what about the sanctity, evidentiary value of that witness? Section 7 of the Oaths Act takes care of that situation. It says even if the oath or affirmation is not in the form in which it should be administered or if there is any irregularity, it will not invalidate the proceedings or render the evidence inadmissible. Section 7 takes care of that situation. Question number 14.
Is it not true that a witness to whom no oath or affirmation has been administered under Section 4.1 of the Oaths Act 1969 does not have any obligation to state the truth?
That is a popular misconception. If no oath is administered to me, why should I tell the truth? And even if I do not tell the truth, can I be prosecuted for perjury? Because I did not take any oath. No oath was administered to me. No affirmation was administered to me. That's a wrong view because notwithstanding that, the last part of Section 7, the last portion of Section 7 of the Oaths Act, I will read that. No omission to take any oath or make any affirmation, no substitution of any one for the other of them, and no irregularity whatever in the administration of any oath or affirmation or in the form in which it is administered shall invalidate any proceedings or render inadmissible any evidence whatever or in respect of which omission, substitution or irregularity took place or shall affect the obligation of a witness to state the truth. Notwithstanding the fact that there is no oath or there is irregularity in the oath, it will not affect the obligation of the witness to tell the truth. Yes.
Okay, Mr. Rao.
Question number 15.
Yes, sir.
Does the Oaths Act 1969 deal with the competency of the witness.
Does it not deal with the competency of the witness?
It does not.
The Oath Act does not deal with the competency of the witness. Competency of the witness is decided or will have to be decided with reference to Section 118 of the Evidence Act, not with reference to Oath Act. The main object of the Oath Act, we have already seen, is to render persons who give false evidence liable for prosecution. This was the interpreting these provisions, the Justice Vivian Bose in Rameshwar versus State of Rajasthan. I already given the citation. Year 1952, Supreme Court 54 clarified this aspect. There's a division bench of the Kerala High Court also speaking through Justice U. Lakshmi Narayana Bhatt, that is Ponnumani versus State of Kerala, 1987, Volume 2, KLT 1042. Therefore, notwithstanding the fact that there is omission of absence of oath or irregularity in the oath, that will not exempt the witness from stating the truth. Yes.
16. What is the purpose of voir dire examination in the context of Section 118 of the Evidence Act and Section 4 of the Oaths Act 1969 in the case of a child witness?
Now, we have already seen that voir dire is a French word and the meaning is to state the truth. Now, to state the truth is has two aspects. One is his ability to state the truth, his knowledge, his understanding that he has to state the truth, and the consequence of not stating the truth or stating a falsehood. These two aspects are there. Therefore, there is a dual purpose to be served through a sort of twin satisfaction to be arrived at by the court. One under Section 118 of the Evidence Act regarding the competency of the child witness, that is the capacity or intelligence of the child to comprehend or grasp the questions put to it and give rational answers to those questions by adhering to the duty of speaking the truth. That is one aspect. The second aspect is under the proviso to Section 4(1) of the Oaths Act 1969 with regard to the understanding of the child. But there is one qualification. Child below 12 years. Age factor comes for the first time under Section 4(1) of the Oaths Act. If it is a child below 12 years, with regard to the understanding of the child as to the nature of oath and the consequence of stating falsehood, that is whether the child knows that he will be punished for lying, that understanding should be there. Then only oath will be administered in the case of a child below 12 years. This was also again beautifully explained in Rameshwar, State of Rajasthan, 1952, AIR 1952, Supreme Court 54. The great Justice Vivian Bose. Then Kerala decision also. Then question number 17.
If after a preliminary examination, the magistrate considers the child witness to be incapable of understanding the nature of oath, is it desirable that the magistrate should make any further record before actually examining the child witness?
See, the child witness was asked whether he has the understanding of the oath, the sanctity of oath. The magistrate asked, or the session judge asked the child witness, do you have any knowledge or any awareness about the sanctity of oath? Child says, no, I don't have. I don't know. Then is it not, should the magistrate make a further record? Or should the court make a further record? That twin satisfaction, this is only partial compliance of the twin satisfaction. One satisfaction under the Oaths Act alone is satisfied. Then the magistrate or the court will have to make the further record that even though the child witness is incapable of understanding the nature of oath, he or she understands the duty of speaking the truth under Section 118 of the Evidence Act. In which case alone, he becomes a competent witness who can be examined as a child witness. This was also beautifully stated in Rameshwar. Vivian Bose. In fact, in that case, the trial judge made only one out of the twin satisfaction, he made a record of only one, namely that the child does not know the nature of oath. He did not say further that the child knows the sanctity of stating his truth, about the duty of speaking the truth. That was not stated, which is under 118 of the Evidence Act. Then the Supreme Court, however, said that the very fact that the court took evidence of the child will indicate that the trial judge was aware of the proviso to Section 4.1. Therefore, they condoned the absence of a record in the deposition of the child witness. This is what the Supreme Court said. In that particular, having regard to the particular facts and circumstances of the case, the Supreme Court condoned the absence about that record. The trial judge ought to record a finding regarding competency. This is what the Supreme Court said. But in the particular facts of the case, the apex court assumed that the trial judge had in mind the proviso to Section 4.1 to Section 5 of the Indian Oaths Act. That is this case under the Indian Oaths Act 1873, corresponding to the proviso to Section 4.1 of the Oaths Act 1969. That is how the question was resolved. Actually, there should be a record regarding the satisfaction, the twin satisfaction arrived at under the Evidence Act and as well as under the Oaths Act. Yes.
Yeah, Kapaswami.
Question 18.
Does not the Indian Evidence Act 1872 prescribe a minimum age for a child witness to be a competent witness?
Indian Evidence Act 118 does not prescribe any age limit that I already stated at the threshold. A child of tender age can be allowed to testify if he or she has the intellectual capacity to understand the questions put to it and give rational answers to those questions. Then this was beautifully stated by Justice Arijit Prasad speaking for the bench in Ratan Singh Dalsukh Bhai Nayak versus State of Gujarat, AIR 2004 Supreme Court, page 23. This decision has been followed in many other rulings of the Supreme. Yes. Question 19.
If during the preliminary examination by the judge, a child witness aged 8 years tells the judge that he has been brought there to give evidence about his mother's death, and when asked whether he knows the judge on the dais or the advocate standing before him, the child replies that he does not know who they are in such a situation, is not the judge justified in not examining the child witness?
This is precisely what a particular judge did in a particular case. The witness was asked, do you know the person standing in front of you, the defense lawyer? Do you know me? In fact, in Kerala also, one magistrate asked the child witness, do you know who I am? The magistrate asked from the dais. I don't know who you are. This was the answer given by the witness, child, by the child. But is the child expected, is the magistrate expected to ask such a question? Is it voir dire examination? Is an examination regarding the capacity of the child to tell the truth or to regarding his understanding regarding the sanctity of oath? This should not have been asked. Therefore, in that case, Justice Dr. D.Y. Chandrachud, speaking for the bench.
P. Ramesh versus State.
P. Ramesh P. versus State of...
This case coming from Madurai bench.
I see. Okay.
In High Court, Justice Namamuthu dealt with this case.
I see. All right. Now, there the trial judge did not ask this particular question. Or the relevant question. What was asked was whether the child knows whether the advocate standing before him. He knows the advocate. How is he expected to know the advocate? How is he expected to know the judge? He has come there to give evidence regarding his mother's death. Therefore, the relevant question for voir dire examination ought to have been asked to test the capacity of the child to tell the truth and his understanding regarding the sanctity of oath. These are the aspects on which he should have been asked. And by and large, it should be unrelated to the facts of that case. The questions put to the child should be unrelated to the facts of the case, because that will be unraveled during the testimony of the child, during evidence. 2019 Supreme Court 3559. AR 2019 Supreme Court 3559. Dr. Chandrachud and Indira Banerjee, judges. Judgment by Justice Chandrachud. Question 20.
Professor Mohan.
What should be the presiding judge do while conducting a voir dire examination?
The decision on the question whether the child witness has sufficient intelligence primarily rests with the trial judge, because trial judge alone sees him. Trial judge alone is seeing the witness and assessing his capacity. So who notices his manners, his apparent possession or lack of intelligence, and the said judge may resort to any examination which will tend to disclose his capacity and intelligence as well as his understanding regarding the obligation of oath. The decision of the trial court may, however, be disturbed by the higher court, because it is an unwritten rule that the trial judge, while putting the questions to during voir dire examination, should record the questions and the answers. Then only a superior court, for example, in that Madurai case, the most irrelevant question was asked by the judge. Therefore, because the judge had recorded that question, the Supreme Court could evaluate whether the relevant question was asked or not. Therefore, the questions put and the answers given during voir dire examination should be part of the record of the deposition of the particular child witness. And therefore, the appellate court, the superior court, can also overturn the decision of the trial court if the proper examination has not been done. This precaution is necessary because child witnesses are amenable to tutoring and often live in a world of make-believe. They live in a world of make-believe. Though it is an established principle that a child witnesses generally are dangerous witnesses, as they are pliable and liable to be influenced easily, shaken and molded. But it is also an accepted norm that after careful scrutiny of their evidence, the court comes to the conclusion that there is an impress of truth in the testimony of the witness. There is no obstacle in the way of the court accepting the testimony of the witness. In fact, corroboration, as we always say, corroboration is not necessary, though it is desirable in certain cases, depending on the vacillating tendency of a child. Or supposing a child prevaricates, vacillates, then the court may look for some corroboration, some other supporting evidence. Otherwise, his testimony can be the sole basis for a conviction if it is otherwise credible. AR 2008 Supreme Court 1460, Dr. Arijit Pasai speaking for the bench, consisting of Justice Sadashivam also. AR 2008 Supreme Court 1460. It was approved by a 3-judge bench in AIR 2009 Supreme Court 2292. To AIR 2009 Supreme Court 2292, 3 judges. Question 21.
Yeah, Mr. Rao.
Yep. Should there be a child-friendly atmosphere set up for recording the evidence in the case of vulnerable victims of child sex abuse?
This question has become relevant after the enactment of the POCSO Act. POCSO Act is the Protection of Children, from Sexual Offences Act 2012, called POCSO Act. After the verdict of the Supreme Court in Sakshi, that this aspect came to the limelight. Now, in State of Maharashtra versus Bandu, alias Daulat, to AIR 2017 Supreme Court 5414, Justice A.K. Goyal speaking for the bench, consisting of Uday U. Lalit also, observed as follows. Before parting with this order, we may deal with the suggestion of learned amicus curiae that there should be special centers for examination of vulnerable witnesses in criminal cases, in the interest of conducive environment in court, so as to encourage a vulnerable victim to make a statement. Such centers ought to be set up with all necessary safeguards. Our attention has been drawn to the guidelines issued by the Delhi High Court for recording evidence of vulnerable witnesses in criminal matters, and also the fact that 4 special centers have been set up in Delhi for the purpose. We find merit in this said suggestion. In fact, the Supreme Court was relying on Sakshi versus Union of India, 2004, Volume 5, SEC 518. 2004, Volume 5, SEC 518. In fact, then the court gave the following directions. 1. The provisions of subsection 2 of section 327 CRPC shall, in addition to the offenses mentioned in that subsection, namely rape and other related offenses, also apply in an inquiry or trial of offenses under section 354 and 377 IPC, unnatural offense and outraging the modesty of a woman. That is also included by the judges. And the 327, therefore, in camera trial in camera, that is not in open court. In camera means in a closed courtroom. Then in holding trial of a child sex abuse, trial of a child involved in a sex abuse rape case, a screen or some other arrangement may be made where the victim or witness who may be equally vulnerable like the victim, witness also can be equally vulnerable like the victim, do not see the body or the face of the accused. Victim or the witness, child witness, does not see the accused because he may get terrified by looking at the accused. At the same time, accused should be able to see the witness. The question put in cross-examination on behalf of the accused, insofar as they relate directly to the incident, should be given in writing to the presiding officer of the court, who may put them to the victim or witness in a language which is clear and is not embarrassing. Then third direction was, the victim of child abuse while giving testimony in court should be allowed sufficient breaks as and when required. It should not be an examination at one single stretch, should be given sufficient breaks. Then the fourth, then these directions are in addition to the direction given by the Supreme Court in State of Punjab versus Gurmeet Singh, 1996, Volume 2, SEC 384. 1996, Volume 2, SEC 384, Gurmeet Singh. Then you may also refer to Para 21 of Ramesh P. versus State represented by Inspector Police, AR 2019, Supreme Court 3559, which arose from Madurai. Justice Chandrachud. Then we pass
section
on to
question. 33 and section 33 of POXO Act also specifically says
What are
the usual safeguards applied by courts while evaluating the testimony of a child witness?
Here I wish to give an elaborate answer so that those of you who are practicing on the criminal side will be well informed about this. Here the relevance of section 33 of the POXO Act, etc., will come into forefront. On the question whether corroboration of a child witness is necessary or not, I will deal with this under 4 main heads. 1, whether corroboration of a child witness is necessary. 2, what about the delay in lodging the first information statement? Delay in lodging the complaint. Then 2, the consent jurisprudence under the rape. What all the consent, the nuances of consent in criminal trials, then rape trials. Then inadequacies, deficiencies in the investigating, prosecuting and judicial proceedings. The inadequacies taken note of by the Supreme Court. All under these 4 heads, I will give you the answer. Now on the question of corroboration, it is whether it is necessary or not, you may kindly bear in mind the following principles evolved by the Supreme Court. 1, in Para 19, we have already seen the Rameshwar versus State of Rajasthan, AR 1952, Supreme Court, page 54. There an 8-year-old girl was ravished. Supreme Court, speaking through Justice Vivian Bose, observed as follows in Para 19. There is no rule of practice that there must in every case be corroboration before a conviction can be allowed to stand. Way back in 1952, Supreme Court said so. In spite of that, there are very many cases, very many courts look for corroboration even in a case where the testimony of the witness is quite credible, quite inspiring. Then second, Justice M.P. Tucker, speaking for the bench in Barwada Boginbhai Harji Bhai versus State of Gujarat, 1983, Volume 3, SEC 217, 1983, Volume 3, SEC 217, involving indecent sexual assault and rape of two young girls, aged 10 or 12, after adverting to Rameshwar, etc., observed as follows. In the Indian setting, refusal to act on the testimony of a victim of sexual assault in the absence of corroboration as a rule is adding insult to the injury. The trial before the court should not be more tormenting or more harrowing than the offense of rape itself. The child has undergone a very, very tormenting act of rape. Then in the court also, the child should not be subjected to such an harrowing experience. Therefore, it will amount to adding insult to injury. Beautifully stated by Justice Tucker, M.P. Tucker. Then after comparing the females in the Western and Indian society, the learned judge said that regarding the inhibitions of a girl in the tradition-bound, non-permissive Indian society to narrate the scary details of a carnal outrage which she had undergone. When a girl of tender years is speaking about the carnal outrage which she had undergone, the gory details of that, the courts have to be informed about the tradition-bound, non-permissive Indian society in contradistinction with the Western society. That should be uppermost in the mind of the trial judge. Then third decision is Vijay alias Chini versus State of Madhya Pradesh. 2010, Volume 8, SEC 191. 2010, Volume 8, SEC 191. Dr. Justice B.S. Chauhan, speaking for Justice Sadashivam as well, held that if the statement of the prosecutor is to be found to be worthy of credence and reliable, it does not require any corroboration and that it can form the sole basis for a conviction. It can form the sole basis for a conviction. Again, in Radu versus State of Madhya Pradesh, 2007, Volume 12, SEC 57. 2007, Volume 12, SEC 57. Justice R.V. Ravindran, speaking for the bench, observed as follows. It is now well settled that a finding of guilt in a case of rape can be based on the uncorroborated evidence of the prosecutrix. The very nature of the offense makes it difficult to get direct or corroborating evidence because these offenses are done in secrecy. The evidence of the prosecutrix should not be rejected on the basis of minor discrepancies and contradictions. If the victim of rape states on oath that she was forcibly subjected to sexual intercourse, her statement will normally be accepted even if it is uncorroborated, unless the material on record requires drawing of an inference that there was no consent or the incident was improbable or imaginary. Except in such cases, rare cases, the testimony of a rape victim should be the last word for the judge and for the system. Even if there is consent, the learned judge reminded, even if there is consent, the act will still be rape if the girl is under 16 years of age. That is beyond the age of consent, below the age of consent. Then in fifth case is State of Maharashtra versus Chandra Prakash Kewalchand Jain. AR 1990 Supreme Court 658, that was involving a rape of a teenager girl by a police officer. The Apex Court speaking through Justice Ahmadi on behalf of Justice Fatima Bibi as well, observed as follows. A prosecutrix of a sex offense cannot be put on par with an accomplice. Who is an accomplice? Accomplice is a participant, is a partner in crime. But she is not a partner in crime. You don't treat her as an accomplice. She is in fact a victim of the crime. Evidence Act nowhere says that her evidence cannot be accepted unless it is corroborated in material particulars. She is undoubtedly a competent witness under Section 118 of the Evidence Act, and her evidence must receive the same weight as is attached to an injured witness. A cases of injury, supposing there is an injured witness, she is also an injured witness. Treat her on par with an injured witness. The same degree of care and caution must attach in the evaluation of her evidence as in the case of injured complainant or witness, and no more. What is necessary is that the court must be alive and conscious of the fact that it is dealing with the evidence of a person who is interested in the outcome of the charge leveled by her. To insist on corroboration, except in the rarest of rare cases, is to equate a woman who is a victim of the lust of another with an accomplice to a crime, and thereby insult womanhood. You are insulting womanhood by calling her an accomplice to a crime, and thereby it would be adding insult to injury to tell a woman that her story of woe will not be believed unless it is corroborated on material particulars, as in the case of an accomplice of a crime. Courts must always realize that ordinarily a woman, more so a young girl, will not stake her reputation by leveling a false charge concerning her chastity. She is making it a charge against a person who has meddled with her chastity. Normally, in the Indian setting, normally, of course, there can be exceptions. Supreme Court has gone to the extent of saying that even a prostitute can say no consent. Even a prostitute can say that, no, I don't consent to sexual intercourse. Don't come near me. She may be a prostitute. She may be having very bad reputation. Still, at a given time, she can say no. No consent. And sixth case is, the evidence of a child witness if found reliable can be the basis for a conviction. There is no rule or practice that in every case, evidence of a child witness should be corroborated before a conviction can be recorded. However, as a rule of prudence, the court always finds it desirable to have corroboration to such evidence from other dependable evidence on record. 1997, Volume 5, SEC 341, Justice Nanavati and Justice S.P. Kurdukar is the author of the judgment, was referred to. Then, seventh case, Para 9 of Radhesham versus State of Rajasthan, 2014, Volume 5, SEC 389, 2014, Volume 5, SEC 389. A two-judge bench of the Supreme Court adverting to Rameshwar, etc., that is 52 Supreme Court, etc., laid down the following principles. The evidence of a child witness must be evaluated more carefully and with proper and greater circumspection, because a child is susceptible to be swayed by what others tell him. A child is always fickle-minded, is susceptible to what others tell him. That should be borne in mind by the judge. A child witness is an easy prey to tutoring. Hence, the evidence of a child witness must be subjected to close scrutiny to rule out the possibility of tutoring. Appropriate questions can be asked. If the prosecutor doesn't ask, the court can step in. Under Section 165 of the Evidence Act, court has got enormous powers. The presiding judge, trial judge has got enormous powers to intervene. In fact, in the entire gamut of criminal trial, the presiding judge is the only person who can ask even irrelevant questions. Whereas either the prosecutor or the defense counsel cannot ask irrelevant questions. Court can ask irrelevant questions. Please read Section 165 of the Evidence Act. The court can always step in. Then, the evidence of a child witness must find adequate corroboration before it is relied upon. Not always. There can be situations. If found reliable and truthful and corroborated by other evidence on record, it can be accepted. That is in a case where corroboration is necessary. If the court finds that the child witness has sufficient intelligence and understanding of the obligation of truth, obligation of the oath, the sanctity of oath, the evidence of the child witness can be relied upon. Then I come to the next facet, namely delay. Delay in lodging the first information statement or complaint. See, in any criminal jurisprudence, whether it is preventive detention or regular criminal trial, delay by itself is never fatal. What is fatal is unexplained delay. If the delay has been properly explained, how can it be fatal? If there is an explanation for the delay, whether it is for interrogation, supposing a particular witness was interrogated by an investigating officer months after the occurrence, there can be valid explanation offered for the delay. If that explanation is convincing, court will not shut out the testimony of the witness by saying that, no, you were questioned only after 3 months. There can be valid explanation. Likewise, especially in a case of rape, it involves the question of honor of the family. See, very often people are reluctant because it may affect the marriage prospects of the girl. All these circumstances will have to be taken into consideration while considering the question of delay. So if the delay, there is some explanation for the delay, it can never be fatal. You may refer to Santosh Moolya versus State of Karnataka, AR 2010, Supreme Court 2247. AR 2010, Supreme Court 2247. It cannot be fatal. In fact, that was a case where there was a delay of 42 days. Still, Supreme Court said it is not fatal. So it is always unexplained delay which is fatal. Never explained delay. Explained delay can never be fatal. And the third aspect is the consent jurisprudence. Because I am not expatiating the principles, because this is not a lecture on rape trial. This is a lecture on child witness. Therefore, I am only giving you the citation. The first and foremost is to keep the anonymity of the rape victim. To keep the rape victim anonymous. State of Himachal Pradesh versus Srikanth Shikari, AR 2004, Supreme Court, 4404. AR 2004, Supreme Court, 4404. Justice Arijit Pasayat speaking for the bench, interpreting Section 228A of the Indian Penal Code, emphasized the need for keeping anonymity of the victim, even in judicial verdicts, not only by the police and by the investigating officer and prosecuting officer. Even in judicial verdicts, but very often this is more honored in its breach than observance. On the question of consent, it was held that it was for the accused to prove that the victim had consented to the sexual intercourse, and that it is not for the victim to prove absence of consent. It is for the accused to prove that there was consent, and not for the victim to say that she did not consent to the sexual intercourse. Then the contours of consent for sexual intercourse was expatiated by Justice R.M. Lodha, speaking for the bench in AIR 2011, Supreme Court, page 697. Again, in State of UP versus Manoj Kumar Pandey, AIR 2009, Supreme Court, 711. Again, 1997, volume 11, SEC, pages 191. 1997, volume 11, SEC, page 191. And AIR 2000, Supreme Court, 1812. AIR 2000, Supreme Court, 1812, three judges. The apex court observed that consent of the victim is not to be inferred merely because she was above the age of 16. Just because she is above 16, court cannot straightaway presume consent. Consent is not something to be inferred. It has to be adduced on evidence on this strength. Then I come to the last category, namely inadequacies and deficiencies in the investigating, prosecuting, and judicial functions. In Delhi Domestic Working Women's Forum versus Union of India, 1995, Volume 1, SEC, page 14, a three-judge bench of the Supreme Court, speaking through Justice S. Mohan, took judicial notice of the escalating crimes against women and the defects and inadequacies in the existing investigating, prosecuting, and judicial systems. The need for legal representation of the victim at every stage, right from the police station, was emphasized by the learned judge. Because I am not expatiating more, because it is not a lecture on rape trial. Then in Sakshi, it's a beautiful landmark decision, a turning point. Sakshi versus Union of India, AR 2004, Supreme Court 3566, AR 2004, Supreme Court 3566, rendered on 26-5-2004, Justice G.P. Mathur, speaking for the bench, noticed the deficiencies and inadequacies in the system, even in the definition of rape under Section 375. And Supreme Court took notice of the fact that the existing definition of rape takes in only the heterosexual intercourse. After considering the foreign jurisdictions, the bench emphasized the need for proving protection to the victims of sexual abuse, providing protection to the victims of sexual abuse. Then the following directions, the recommendations were made by the Supreme Court in Sakshi. In fact, we are happy to note that they have been translated into reality by the legislature in the various forms of POKSO. Mr. Karupaswamy was mentioning about Section 33. We'll refer to that. First direction was, the court should provide a child-friendly atmosphere while the child victims depose before court. This has been taken care of in Section 33.4 of the POKSO Act. Section 33.4. Second direction was, videotaping of the child's statement given to the judge. Videotaping. Taken care of in Section 36.2. Section 36.2 of the POKSO Act. Then a meaningful application of Section 273 CRPC, enabling the child witness to testify without exposing him or her to the accused by using a closed circuit television, providing a single visibility screen which will not allow the child to see the accused. That has been taken care of by Section 36.1, clauses 1 and 2. Subsections 1 and 2 of Section 36 of the POKSO Act. In fact, under Section 273 CRPC, all of you are aware that evidence before a court in a criminal trial has to be taken, recorded in the presence of the accused. So the presence of the accused cannot be dispensed with when evidence is being recorded, except in very, very few situations. Therefore, accused has a right to be present when evidence is recorded. So the Supreme Court was considering about this aspect, how to harmonize Section 273 with the requirements of the protection of the child witness. And Supreme Court said, you can provide for a single visibility screen, which will not allow the child to see the accused, but the accused can see the child, and etc. Then fourth recommendation was, examination of the child to be carried out by submitting written questions by the public prosecutor and the defense counsel to the judge in advance, and the judge putting those questions to the child in a child-friendly manner, taken care of by Section 33, Clause 2 of POKSO Act. Then fifth direction was, child to be given sufficient breaks during the course of his or her testimony, taken care of in Section 33.3, subsection 3 of Section 33, and subsections 5 and 6 also. Subsections 3, 5 and 6 of section 33 of POKSO Act taken care of, has taken care of this aspect. Then section 326, 6th direction was, 6th recommendation was, section 326 to CRPC should be given a meaningful interpretation by holding the trial in camera in cases involving female sexual abuse, as highlighted in Gurmeet Singh's case. Gurmeet Singh was 1996, 2 SEC 384. And that has been taken care of by section 37 of POKSO Act. Section 37 of POKSO Act. Then the last recommendation was, in appropriate cases, examination of the child can be on a commission under section 284 CRPC at a place other than the court. The child need not be driven or dragged to the court for his examination. The child or he or she can be examined on commission under section 284 CRPC. That has been taken care of by the POKSO Act under section 37, proviso to section 37 of POKSO Act. These are my impression, my takes on the question 22. Yes, we pass on to question 23.
23 by Mr. Shyam.
Yeah, the subtle distinction between the ability of the child to depose but inability to comprehend the oath. A sessions judge during voir dire examination of a female child aged 12 years finds the child intelligently answering the questions put to her, but observes that even though the child understands the duty of speaking the truth, does not understand the nature of oath. Accordingly, her evidence is taken without administering oath to her. Is there any irregularity on the part of the sessions judge?
See, when you read the proviso to section 4.1 of the Oaths Act, you must have noticed that this inquiry regarding this, the requisite satisfaction to be arrived at by the court is applicable or is necessary only in the case of a child below the age of 12 years. Below the age of 12 years. Here is a child which has attained the age of 12 years. 12 years and above, administering oath is a must. If the child is aged 12 years and above, administering oath is a must. Court need not go into an inquiry as to whether the child understands the sanctity of oath, etc. That question, that inquiry will arise only in the case of a child below 12 years. That is, the session judge was not right in making an investigation into that and without taking evidence. But then, notwithstanding that, the section 7 of the Oaths Act says, notwithstanding the omission to take oath, the witness cannot be absolved of its duty to speak the truth, which is the competency of the child under section 118 of the Evidence Act. Yes. I put this question only to notice the distinction, the age limit, 12 years. Below 12 years is the proviso. Only if the child is below 12 years, you need to comply with the proviso. If the child is aged 12 years or more, proviso need not be complied. Oath has to be mandatorily administered. Oath or affirmation. Yes.
No.
Yes, sir. Question 24. Give a few instances in which the Supreme Court accepted the testimony of a child witness.
This is only for those practitioners who may have to rely on cases where the child witness testimony was accepted. And next question is cases in which the testimony was not accepted, so that you can rely on those rulings appropriately, only for doing justice, not for doing injustice, mind you. In Rameshwar, we have already seen, versus State of Rajasthan, year 1952, Supreme Court 54, Justice Vivian Bose, speaking for the bench, was concerned with the testimony of a rape victim who was aged 7 or 8 years. Mind you, way back in 1952, the victim of rape was only aged 7 or 8. While confirming the conviction and sentence, notwithstanding the fact that the trial judge did not certify that the child witness does not understand the duty of speaking the truth within the meaning of the proviso to section 4 of the Oaths Act, the Supreme Court said, just the very fact that the trial judge proceeded to examine the child will show that not Oaths Act, under Section 118, the competency of the witness, though there was no record or finding regarding that, the very fact that the trial judge proceeded to record the testimony of the witness will show that he had in mind the proviso to Section 4 of the Oaths Act. Then, second is Nivruti Pandurang Kokate versus State of Maharashtra, AR 2008 Supreme Court 1460, AR 2008 Supreme Court 1460. Conviction of the accused person for murder was based on the testimony of 12-year-old daughter of the deceased, and the Supreme Court confirmed the conviction and sentence, observing that the testimony of the child witness had an impress of truth. She was only aged 12 years. It had an impress of truth. Then the third case, Himat Sukhdev Vahurbag versus State of Maharashtra, AR 2009 Supreme Court 2292. AR 2009 Supreme Court 2292. Three judges. The trial judge observing inter alia that testimony of the 11-year-old witness who was in the company of the deceased persons was acquitted the accused persons. On appeal, the High Court reversed the acquitted and convicted the accused persons for murder and related offenses by placing reliance on the testimony of the 11-year-old child. On further appeal, Supreme Court approved the conviction, saying that the trial judge had not appreciated. I have earlier said that the voir dire examination record can be looked into by the Superior Court to ascertain whether there was proper examination or not. This is one such case where the Superior Court, the High Court, after examining the voir dire examination, came to the conclusion that the trial judge did not properly apply the testimony of the witness, and accordingly recorded an acquittal, but it was wrong acquittal, and the High Court reversed the acquittal and confirmed the and recorded a conviction. The conviction was approved by the Supreme Court. Fourth case is Suresh versus State of UP, AIR 1981 Supreme Court 1122. The testimony of a solitary 5-year-old eyewitness was believed for convicting the trusted servant for murdering the housewife and her three-year-old child. The so-called trusted servant had murdered the housewife and her three-year-old child. This was witnessed by a 5-year-old child who had survived, who had escaped unhurt. That testimony was relied on by the Supreme Court. In last case is Satish versus State of Haryana, AIR 2017 Supreme Court 3437, a 12-year-old son of the deceased was believed by the trial court and the High Court, and finally by the Supreme Court to record the conviction and sentence. Next question, last question.
Do we read the 25th question, because that's interwoven?
25th.
I'm saying that is rather interwoven what you have said. No, has there been any
rejecting?
That is the contra. Yes.
Yes. I'm reminded of Justice Mehta saying on the farewell that the lawyers know the truth, but it is the judge who is on the trial.
First case is State of Assam versus Mufizuddin Ahmad, AR 1983 Supreme Court 274. The Apex Court made the following observation regarding the 7-year-old solitary eyewitness, that case was a case of bride burning. The bride was burned to death. A bare perusal of the deposition of PW7 convinces us that he was vacillating throughout, and has deposed that he was asked to depose either by his nana or by his own uncle. He was giving evidence on the instructions of his nana or his own uncle. And the child was, 7-year-old child was vacillating and prevaricating. So court was very, very easily, court was able to see through the game. Therefore, ultimately the court did not believe the witness, did not treat the witness as the believable. And it was confirmed by the High Court and by the Supreme Court. Yet another case is Radhesham versus State of Rajasthan, 2014, volume 5, SEC 389. 2014, volume 5, SEC 389. The evidence of PW to a 10-year-old boy by name Banwari was not accepted by the Supreme Court as one conforming to the standards expected of a child witness. The appellant was accordingly acquitted by the Supreme Court for the first time. Then third is Digambar Vaishnav versus State of Chhattisgarh, AR 2019, Supreme Court 1367. AR 2019, Supreme Court 1367. Three judges, the Supreme Court. They did not accept the testimony of PW8, a 9-year-old girl, and reversed the conviction of the appellant, who was accordingly found not guilty and was acquitted and set at liberty by the Supreme Court. So there, I have given you the citations where the testimony of the child witness had been accepted even without corroboration, and the testimony of eyewitnesses, child witness was not accepted by the Supreme Court. Therefore, in appropriate cases, you can make use of these rulings to buttress your point, provided you are doing justice to the case. With that, we come to a close of today's articulation. Thank you.
Yes, sir. So, we will finally say the vote of thanks when we will praise and at the end, how we have all enriched from that knowledge. But yes, during all the session, we also felt that there's a requirement of a session on, since there was a lot of interplay of under 376 also, that we should have a session on this, how to go about it.
376, it will not be over in 5 or 6 sessions. 376 is such a vast subject.
That's true. We know that you work tirelessly and we don't get tired hearing you.
I am not indefatigable.
No, you are. So what is the credibility of a child witness below 12 years in a POSCO case? This is by Ramachandra.
Credibility of a child witness attained 12 years. That all depends on the manner in which the evidence is given. If there is an impress of truth in the testimony, even if it is, if the witness is aged 12 years, oath has to be administered out of as a rule, because the question whether oath is to be administered or not will arise only in the case of a child witness below the age of 12 years. If it has attained a 12 years or above, then oath has to be administered. Then that doesn't mean that the testimony is admissible. Testimony can be relied on in each and every case. It all depends on the impress of truth in the testimony of the witness. The child is able to inspire the confidence of the court. Nothing prevents the court from accepting the testimony of the child witness even without a corroboration. It can form the sole basis for a conviction. Corroboration, I said, corroboration is a supporting evidence. When the testimony of the child witness itself being substantive evidence is otherwise reliable, credible, then court need not look for corroboration. That itself can form the sole basis for a conviction.
This is why are courts reluctant to take action against any person administering false oath in court, and once he is lying in the court by misusing the discretion, why doesn't the court exercise the powers under 340?
Courts do exercise, but then see, Supreme Court has cautioned that every falsehood, even in the case of our own Chief Minister K. Karunakaran, Kerala Chief Minister, even in the case of K. Karunakaran versus State of Kerala, Supreme Court has cautioned that it is not every falsehood which has to be taken note of by the court and for prosecuting for perjury. In that case, the sharpness of the prosecution for perjury will get blunted. That's what the word used by the Supreme Court. It is not to be exercised every now and then. And you are sidetracking the fee. When you have got so many cases pending for trial, and if in each and every case you are going to take action for perjury of every each and every witness examined in each and every case, the precious time of the court will be wasted also. So courts very often do not find time for taking action for perjury. Of course, there can be, I have taken action for perjury. But it's a cumbersome procedure. Court will have to conduct a 340 inquiry, not necessarily always, but 340 inquiries invariably done. And then court will have to make a tentative finding that he appears to have committed an offense punishable under section 193 of the Indian Penal Code, for which he has to be prosecuted. And then the court will have to give a complaint. Of course, court means court, an authorized officer, an officer authorized by the court will have to file a complaint before the magistrate concerned. All these are all time-consuming process. So the court will have to leave the main roster and go to prosecuting witnesses for perjury. That is why very often courts do not exercise this power. It will be an exercise in futility in some cases. Yes.
Last question, whether the omission to put oath to child witness who is below 12 years affects the credibility in any manner?
I have already answered that. It does not affect the credibility. Just because the oath is, the child does not know the sanctity of oath. That is, so the oath need not be administered, that's all. Section 4 proviso, 4.1 proviso, and section 7 read together will show that will not dispense with the obligation of the witness to speak the truth. And if not, and just because oath has not been administered, the child does not get a license to speak falsehood, to speak lies. Even child, not only child, even adult.
Yeah.
Yes.
The Krupa Swami says, if above 12, that you also have answered. As they say, that all good things do come to an end. But as they say, that if you have a good and erudite speaker who could propose the vote of, who could initiate the session, that is Mr. Shyam, we can also ask him to propose the vote of thanks for the today's session, the way you are taking things forward. People only send us messages, not only on the WhatsApp, but also on the YouTube, etc., to state therein that you should call Justice Ramkumar to have, so that we can have deeper insights. We do not need to plunge into the books, because in 1 hour session and 1.5 hour session, we get all the insights from bird eye view to the entire 3D views. Over to you, Shyam.
So what else can I say? A big thank you. And please do try to accommodate the request being made in the chat regarding 376, because I think they are more eager with this three regarding 376 than anything else. Like, I mean,
I am not an expert on rape.
Sir, it was a very, very enlightening session, very simple, very lucid. And the manner in which, I did not repeat that again, but still, the questions were framed that every nuances of that particular provision or that subject was able to be covered. And it did give us an opportunity to revisit all those basic ideas about our principles regarding those aspects. Thank you very much, sir. And it was wonderful to be part of any platform wherein you are presenting a talk on any subject for that matter. Because it is wonderful that you could get Ramkumar sir again with this wonderful topic. And we are also thankful to Justice P.S. Narayana, Professor Balla sir, K.V.J. Rao, Karapuswami, and all of you wonderful participants who are being part and parcel of this journey, wherein Vikas has been exposing us almost daily to different thoughts and ideas. Once again, thank you, Ramkumar sir, for this.
Thank you.
The sure. way in which it presented the topic, the subject, the depth to which you have taken us on this subject. Thank you very much.
I can say that though we took the session on the child's witness credibility, etc., but sir has made understand this entire gamut of law, just like even an ordinary person can understand, even a child can understand what is the journey of law in this aspect. And we are always indebted to Justice Ramkumar, the way he takes things forward. And tomorrow, do stay connected with us to have understanding of registration of charitable trust societies under the Income Tax Act by Rano Jain, an advocate and a former member of the Income Tax Appellate Tribunal. And we are all thankful to Professor Mohan, Justice Rao, and Mr. K.K. Rao, and Pura Swami, and all others participants who have been watching us live on the YouTube, Facebook, as well as on this platform itself. Keep encouraging us. that makes us more motivated. So it's always a pleasure connecting with good people on this platform. And as they say, two is a tango when Justice Ram Kumar comes. Today, though, we are missing Mr. Prem. So Ram, Sham and Prem, they make a trio combination, which is heartening and encouraging for all of us to learn the nuances of law. Everyone stay safe, stay blessed. And those who have not got vaccinated, do get yourself vaccinated and be home if not required at the same time to go outside. Thank you. Namaskar.
Thank you.
Adios, amigos.
And happy Eid to one and all. Let prosperity prosper in the nation and global wise. Thank you.
Thank you.
Eid Mubarak.